بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. I wanted to talk to you about the masculinity of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. His رجولة. Okay, he's رجال. He's رجل. Sorry, رجال is the plural. And why that is important. You know, in this talk, I mean, this world today with masculinity, with the red pill, and people have awoken and realized that, look, there's a problem. We are lacking masculinity. We are suffering. Now, of course, sadly, the sisters would say stuff like, no, this is toxic masculinity. And subhanAllah, if you look at what they define toxic masculinity, because they're influenced by feminism, would be certain characteristics that the Prophet ﷺ would display themselves. But again, it's picking and choosing. And Allah says, أَفَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِبَعْدِ الْكِتَابِ وَتَكْفُرُونَ بِبَعْدِ. Do you believe in part of the book and disbelieve in the other one? So I wanted to quote a few statements by Muhammad Ghazali in his Fiqh of Sirah, where he describes the masculinity of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So on page 90, he talks about strength and activity. And it's interesting because it's so relevant to what I'm talking about, so relevant to the work that I'm trying to do, educating boys and males to become men, and the importance of it. Why is it important? How it's going to benefit women and the ummah at large, right? No, the solution is not to have more feminine men. The solution is not to have, you know, more strong women and to empower women. No, it's to have the correct masculinity applied correctly according to the standard of the Quran and Sunnah, you know, the context of the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So let us hear. So the Prophet, Muhammad Ghazali says that when the war, the sacrilegious war stopped, in which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, by the way, took participation, and some sources say that he fought. For those who keep saying that peace, 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 there's a difference between violence and oppression and the ability to know how to fight. And the Prophet ﷺ certainly had the skills of combat. Okay, and I keep telling parents, guys, come on, get your boys to learn how to have skills, fighting skills, because it will help. It will develop their character. So many things. So, anyway, when this war stopped, the Prophet ﷺ basically went back to his, you know, helping his uncle. And it says that because being idle is not manly. Look at that. Look what Muhammad Ghazali says. Being idle is not manly. All right? The Prophet ﷺ, then he says, was a man with a strong body. He was not too tall, but he was tall. He had a good stature. And his amazing strength was noted even 40 years after. The hadith of Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu says, I never saw anyone more handsome. Look at that. He's handsome. When I talk, guys, take care of yourself. Take care of the way you look, the clothes you wear, and so on. He says, the Prophet, I never saw someone more handsome than the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It was as if the sun was shining in his face. And I never saw anyone walk quicker than the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Is as if the earth was folded underneath him. And whenever we walk with him, we would exert ourselves while he was cool. What is that? Stamina. Stamina. Today, mashallah, our brothers, they barely can move, man. Allahu Akbar. Take someone for a jog or play a bit of football. I'm done. Mashallah, we can read Quran. Alhamdulillah, it's good. We can do lectures and, you know, theory. Good. Okay, no problem. But look at the Prophet ﷺ. And look what they're saying. We were walking with him. We would exert ourselves while he was cool because he had stamina. Guys, Muhammad Ghazali says, very important. Such a man attracts life to himself and he is not attracted to life. Okay, very important. What does this mean? It means that people see. He's not going to be unfocused by all the things around, but he's going to be focused and people come to him. People see that he's got the solution to our problems. He's not going to be like, oh, well, look at this, look at that, unfocused. No, that's a big problem for males today. We're unfocused. No, the Prophet ﷺ was attracting things to him, his charisma. People are gravitating around him. Right, so he was a very amazing, very masculine man. And interesting, when he married Khadija radiyallahu anha. Okay? And here we have to say something interesting before I go to that. That strength of character is about controlling desires. That's one thing that we men fail at. If a beautiful woman comes by or something like that, we lose our mind, right? We are controlled sometimes with women, our wives, who control the concept of intimacy. If they want to give it, they give it. If we misbehave or something, you get the couch. And we're so, some men are so whipped to it that they'll do whatever the wife says, even if she's wrong and she misguides them in the deen. And the Prophet said very clearly that a very intellectual man could be misguided by women. Of course, the women, now you're probably going to flip out. Maybe the Salafi feminist or whoever is going to start saying something, or other women who are on the same feminist mentality. But that's not the way the Sahabiyat responded in this hadith. They said, Ya Rasulullah, why? They wanted to know why when you said that many of you or most of you will inhabit hellfire. Most of the inhabitants of hellfire will be women. And yes, I'm aware of Imam Nawawi's commentary on this and so on and others, and I disagree. And there's reason why other scholars have disagreed, not because I disagree. Okay, so don't jump the horse, right? But the Sahabiyat, the reaction, why don't you pay attention to the reaction? I'm sure the women right now will be like, oh my God, that is so bad. Who are you to say this? They wanted to know why, so they can fix themselves. Not so they can challenge and fight and take you out on social media and sue you and whatnot. They wanted to know why, Ya Rasulullah. And then he explained to them why. That's not the reason for this. But nonetheless, the Prophet ﷺ was controlling his desires. He was a man of composure, focus, strength of body, strength of mind, character, but also good looks. Right? Good looks. So he wouldn't be, he's not a wit man. He's not someone like the men that we have today who are so weak, cannot stand their ground. Right? He was very strong man, strong moral, spiritual purity, which would not make him like a toxic masculinity, whatever, because he would give people their rights. He would do the right thing. He would not oppress one. But even the concept of what is right and what is wrong, sadly, our sisters, especially the feminists, and I was reading again something about the Salafi feminists, you know, they put their own conditions and their own standards, that is what is wrong and what is right, what is dhulm and what is not. But I would argue that to understand the definition of what is right and what is wrong, be it in polygyny, be it in masculinity, in marriage, and whatever it is, because we men are being accused today, we're being attacked, always being called to what is wrong, what is right. You guys are using the deen for your own sake. You're quoting hadith and Quran to suit your desires. These are just statements. You cannot prove that unless we go back to the Quran and Sunnah and the application and context to understand what is right and what is wrong. What does this hadith mean in this ayah based on how the Prophet ﷺ lived his life? It's not subjective. It's quite objective because we have all the details of his dealings, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with his wives. So that's the, you know, what you have to return to understand what men are doing in marriage or in polygyny or in masculinity, whether that is right or what is, or that is not right. Not according to your standard, sister, whoever you are, Salafi, feminist and others. Yeah, I'm calling her out because I'm reading some of his stuff and some of the brothers have sent me some of his stuff. And some things make sense, and I have to be honest, okay, that yes, sisters are upset, and yes, there's a reaction, but the solution is not correct. The reaction is incorrect. There might be a problem. Yes, there are some problems, but their solutions are incorrect. So again, فَإِن تَنَزَعْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ فَرُدُّهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. You have to go back to the seerah, you have to go back to the Prophet ﷺ to understand whether this man or whoever he is, he's practicing correct masculinity, correct Islam. Is he using Islam for his benefit to fulfill his desires? If we men wanted to fulfill our desires, it's so easy these days. We don't need you women to marry you. We can fulfill our desire. If it's just about that, if we're being accused that we're using the Islam and fiqh and this and that to fulfill our desires by quoting hadith and Quran, you're totally wrong. You're totally not in the right place. Because if it is about fulfilling desires, then we could have done it a long time. Easy today. It's very cheap, very easy. No headache comes with it. But of course, haram. So if it is about what you're accusing us of, then we can do it. We don't need you. We can do it much easier without the headache, without the challenges, without the responsibilities. It's not about that. That's not how the argument should go to. Oh yeah, you're quoting hadith and Quran and Sunnah, masculinity and this and that, to suit your desires. Okay, dismiss the argument, dismiss everything else, dismiss men, dismiss masculinity, dismiss marriage, polygyny, dismiss everything. Because according to female standard, you know, she says, you're wrong. Wait a second, you are the one dictating what is right and what is wrong in this world? You are the one who understands, contextualizes and knows everything according to whose standards? To your standard? Because you've had a bad, you know, or a raw deal in your experience? No. Anyway, I just wanted to make that point. Let's go back to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When he married Khadija, and he had his, and I want to quote these two people, okay? Because Khadija found what she was looking for. She found the real men who didn't cheat, who worked for her, who she sponsored. He was the man. He was the real deal. But I want to say what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's family said. Abu Talib stood up at the wedding ceremony. And this is where, this is it, man. The real masculinity, real. It says, if Muhammad were weighted with any youth of the Quraysh, he would outweigh him in lineage, nobility, virtue, and intelligence. Okay? If you want to know the standards of a real man. If he has little wealth, let it be known that wealth is fleeing shadow and a borrowed thing which we must return. So, he desires Khadija, and Khadija has the same feelings for him, mashallah. And then Khadija's uncle said something, subhanallah. She said, he is the stallion whose nose cannot be ringed. Allah, and the marriage ceremony was concluded. He is the stallion whose nose cannot be ringed, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. You cannot play with him. You cannot control him because he is a man of focus by the blessings of Allah. To the point that Abu Sufyan, the enemy of Islam, married his daughter, Habiba, to the Prophet and said the same thing. And it was an honor for him. He was an enemy. But he recognized the strength, the masculinity that Allah has given him in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Think about that.